feet from me. May the life I live speak from me.
That was excellent, Brother Cameron. Thank you a lot. That's right on target, but it's a part of the message. Good afternoon again, St. John. It's just a marvelous blessing to come before you again and to be able to share with you a message from the Lord. And I pray that you will be energized and inspired and be blessed the rest of the week. Thank God that he's brought us through another week, and we are continually praying and trusting that he's going to bring us total victory. I want to share with you today a discipleship message that I believe in this time and critical condition that we're going through, we need to rededicate ourselves to be about our discipleship ministry. It's a very familiar passage with all of us, and particularly it's one of my special passages that I have shared before. I preached for it in the Lock Terry Convention, I believe, about like then, maybe then in the 1980s or 90s. It's found in the Gospel of Mark, the second chapter. I need to read at least 12 verses for you to get the entire thrust of the message. And just before I begin, I want you to bow with me in prayer. Almighty God, thank you for another week's journey. Thank you for another privilege and opportunity to share your word with your people. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. Continue to anoint us and bless us, Lord. Anoint this message, anoint me. Anoint the hearts of those who will receive it, and may they apply it in our daily ministry. For I ask you to bless us all in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. In the second chapter, the gospel is recorded by Mark. Listen to his words. And again he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was in the house. And straightway many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them. And they come unto him bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born of four. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, "Son, thy sins be forgiven thee." But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, "Why doth this man thus speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sin but God only?" And immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they so reasoned within themselves, he said unto them, "Why reason ye these things in your heart? Whether is it easier to say to the sick of the palsy, 'Thy sins be forgiven thee,' or to say, 'Arise and take up thy bed and walk'? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins," he said to the sick of the palsy, "I say unto thee, arise, take up thy bed, and go into thy, and go thine own way." And immediately he arose and took up the bed and went forth before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw it on this fashion." From that, I've been led to share with you these words or this subject or theme, compelling love for Christian ministry. Compelling love for Christian ministry. Jesus had been traveling, and so now he's back in Capernaum and everywhere. He made his headquarters, and he's in the house. We do not know exactly whose house it is, but several theologians have surmised that it probably was Peter's house, because he had opened it up for him and invited him to stay and reside with him whenever he was in that area. And so he is preaching the gospel and sharing the word, and the crowd hears about him and all over the territory, the area, and they come and throng so much until they fill the house and fill up the doors and the windows, and no one could even get through to Jesus. And they are listening to him proclaim the gospel of deliverance and salvation. But the interesting thing is these friends of this paralyzed fellow don't know how far he was from the house, or from the condition, whether he was a relative, any one of them, but praise God, he had four friends that thought so much of him. And the first thing I really want to share with us is, if we're going to be good in our Christian ministry and discipleship, the first thing we need is compassion. Think of it, these four brethren who came to this, probably was a buddy, a friend of the house, we have moved together, but since then he'd become paralyzed. And they probably desired to see him healed and cured again. And here they are in the same area and territory. And I'm sure that they must have had love and compassion for him to go through what they did. And so I can see them. They don't think now they had nothing else to do. Some of them probably were a farmer, a merchant, had house chores and business chores. But they gave it up that they might assist their brother because of their love for him, because of compassion. Compassion will drive you to do this. That's what we need in our ministries. We need compassion. We need compassion for all of humanity, and particularly for those who are hurting, and those who are yet unsaved. And I'm sure one of them came and saw him and said, "Oh, brother, I wish that I could get you to Jesus, but I'm not able to carry over. I'm not able to lift you, take you there, that you might be healed. But we love you. We wish that you could do it. We don't know how we would love you. We got to find some way to get you there." And I can see them now as they come together, and he probably one of them said, "Our buddy, Jesus is in the area now, and he's healing people and teaching us. Is there any way we can get our friend to him?" And I can see them now as they come together, and they say, it wouldn't be safe to put him on our shoulder and try to carry them. What can we do?" You see them now becoming sad, and someone came up with the idea, maybe we can we get his pallet there. And the second point I really want to make is, if we're going to be effective in our Christian discipleship and ministry, we need cooperation one with the other. And look how they get together and make a structure and take his pallet and put it on two poles where man could be on the end, two men on the front and two in the rear. And they could lift him up. That required cooperation. And they've been together. If we're going to be effective in our ministry, we need cooperation. What we're going through in our society today, we need cooperation. We need cooperation with our civic, our educational, our society, our ministry. We need cooperation. And so they got together, and because they had compassion and were cooperating together, they came up with a means and an idea of how we can get our friend to Jesus. I can imagine in my mind now seeing them walking and carrying him over the rough terrain, over little hills and valleys, and probably some mud and condition, rocky terrain, and getting there to Jesus. They had compassion, number one. Number two, they cooperated together. Third thing I want us to see is they were committed to get him there to the house. And as a crowd in the house and all around it, they can't get through the door. People are sitting in the windows and they can't get him through the window. You know I'm a fond of a friend of J. Vernon McGee, and I heard him say that he was glad that they had three committees. He said, usually committees don't do anything but take down minutes and waste hours. But he said he praised God for these three committees. He said they they had a door committee, and the committee came back and said, I'm sorry, we can't get him through the door. They had a window committee, and they came back, said, I'm sorry, but we can't get him through the window. But he said, praise God for the roof committee.
Amen.
He went up on the roof, and they saw where they could really remove it. In those days, they had thatch roof and straw and leaves and branches. And they said, I believe that we can open it enough to let him down in the presence of Jesus. But we still have a problem because that's not their house. And if it was Peter's house, I'm sure he wasn't going to allow you tearing up his roof. So I can see them now as they said, who is the owner of this house? He comes out and he said, we brought our friend, our brother, to Jesus, and we love to get him presence that he might heal him. He's paralyzed, and we can't get through the door. We can't get through the window. Will you give us permission to tear back part of the roof and open it up? I believe we can let him down. And don't worry. We'll put it back like we found it. If we can't put it back, you can hire a professional to restore your roof, and we'll pay for it. But we brought him too far to leave him now and to go. We are committed that whatever it costs, we've got to get him to Jesus. So I can see him now on the top of the house, pulling the thatches and roof back, and then open it up, and Jesus is down here still preaching. And I'm sure the parts of leaves and things are falling down in the front of it. And when they get it all the way open, and they somehow found some ropes and tied it around his stretcher and again to lower him down in the front of Jesus. The word said Jesus looked up, saw their faith, said to the sick of the palsy, thy sins be forgiven thee. If you're going to be effective in your discipleship and mission of your ministry, you've got to have compassion. You've got to cooperate together, and you've got to be committed. Can't do it without being committed. We're living in this pandemic time now. If we're going to make it through, we've got to be committed. It means you have to stay there. Things are not working as we would desire and love them to be, but if you are committed, you get results. They're saying we brought him too far to take him back home like we brought him here. We're going to get him, whatever cost, we're going to get him before Jesus. But we see here, that as I studied this over before, I realized that that was not the real issue of this healing ministry that Mark sets before us. So I meditated over it, and the Lord, through the Holy Spirit, gave me something in the conclusion that was I had never seen before. I had sort of missed it. That's why it's good to read the word over and over again. And I saw something that was very interesting. Their focus was not their sick brother. Come on now, help me. Their focus was not their sick brother. Their focus was Jesus. Because if Jesus had not been there in the house, it wouldn't make any difference whether they could bring him in or not. So their focus was Jesus. They hadn't done anything until they heard that Jesus was in the house. And so their real focus was, if we can get him before Jesus, he can be healed.
Yeah.
That should be the center of our ministry. God is to be the center of our focus. Jesus is to be the center of our focus in our discipleship and in our ministry. We've got to get them to Jesus. Doesn't make any difference how much technology you have, and how much medicine you have, and how much money you have, and how much social commitments and things you have, and welfare, things around you. If you can't get them to Jesus, they won't get healed.
Yeah.
But he said, we can get him to Jesus. We believe he can get healed. They believe that Jesus would and could heal him. We've got to have that kind of confidence and faith in Jesus that he will heal you. And he can heal you. I'm so glad about that. That's all I have written down for us today. But praise God, as we look at our circumstances, we ought to be spending this time to get people to Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
We may not be able to pick them up and carry them bodily to Jesus.
Wow.
But we ought to be able to get them there through ministry and doctrine. Well, let me say it another way. If you can't get them to Jesus, you ought to get Jesus to them. By that I mean we ought to carry the word to them. We ought to share the gospel with them. If we live it and share it, we can get them in the presence of the Lord.
Yeah.
And I know if you get them in the presence of the Lord, he will heal them. Oh, Lord, have mercy. When I thought of that, I thought about what my parents did for me.
Yeah.
My parents took me when I was young and took me to the church in a revival time so I could hear about Jesus.
Yeah.
And when I heard about Jesus and the preacher told me about my plight and condition, and I didn't want to die without Jesus, I got up off the mourner's bench and went forth and told the preacher, I'm giving my life to Jesus Christ. That's been a few years ago. And Jesus has been good all my life. Well, hallelujah. Bless his holy name. What we need to do today and have compassion in our heart. And we ought to cooperate with the ministry and the churches and the fellowship, and then we ought to be committed to get men and women, boys and girls to Jesus Christ. If you get them there, Jesus will do his part. Thank you today.
Yes, sir.
Praise his name.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Jesus is still saving.
Yeah.
He's still delivering. Yeah. Mothers and fathers are to tell their children about Jesus. Buddies and friends are to tell their friends about Jesus. Sisters and brothers are to tell one another about Jesus. We are to tell them because Jesus is who they need today. What we're going through, we need Jesus. We don't need all this other stuff, because one day all of this is going to be wiped out. But Jesus, oh, thank you, Lord. He'll be there. Hey, won't he be there?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Aren't you glad you're saved today?
Yeah.
Aren't you glad they were sanctified today? Aren't you glad you've been redeemed today? You ought to be able, even in your home, to just get up and shout and praise the Lord that you have been delivered. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that you had compassion on us. You loved us so much that you were willing to die on the cross that we might be saved. He's still saving. And I've made up my mind that I'm going to share this gospel every opportunity that I get, that someone might be saved. You don't want to die without Jesus. Hallelujah. I'll leave this with you, and I usually share this at a funeral service. And what I use the subject is what you need to know before you go. Amen.
Amen.
What you need to know before you go, because after you're gone, it's too late. Hallelujah. As I come to the close for the benediction, I want to extend and offer even now someone the opportunity of being saved. I tried to deliver this message to get the message to you about Jesus, to get you in the presence of Jesus. I can't heal you, but he can. And if you're a sinner today and you heard this message and you want to be saved, all you have to do is say, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I'm confessing my sin. I'm presenting my heart and my life to you. Will you save me, please? And he will. Just like he healed that man that was let down in his presence. And I just thought of something that's closer. That man, they carried him there to get his body healed. But oh, glory to hallelujah, he got his soul healed also.
Yeah,
that's what it means. See, that's what Jesus does, a complete job. He saves you, heals your body, but then he saves your soul. And that's what he did. And was healed and saved. You can be saved today. You can be delivered. There may be someone who has come slack in their Christian discipleship and ministry, and lost your compassion and your commitment. You can get it back if you just return to the Lord and say, Lord, I confess, I want to come back to you, and I want to carry out my discipleship according to your will. If that's you today, will you do it? And may God bless you. May he keep you another week till we can come together and share another message that he will give us to encourage us and help us through this pandemic time, so we can receive the benediction. Now to him who's able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, now and forever. Amen.